program, we are live. I shall begin. Namaste everyone and good evening. It's a pleasure to have you in our series of Architects Speak 31 organized by SONA. I would like to thank our 13 executive SONA committee, Women in Architecture and Society of Nepalese Architects for organizing this program. Myself, I'm Hina, practicing as an architect since a few years, and I'll be moderating today's series. I would like to request to send all the questions to our speaker in the question box, which will be addressed after the presentation, and also would like to request our senior architects to tap on raise and hand button if they have any thoughts to share. Today's conversation is a part of mentorship series. Mentorship and constructive criticism is essential for growth of designers. Society of Nepalese Architects presentation series is with renowned Bangalore base, distinctly known for use of low energy material and technologies with a special emphasis on bamboo in her numerous reputed projects in India and abroad. With 30 years of experience in the field of sustainable development, she is an architect, planner, scientist, activist, and theoretician with 2 graduate degrees in science as well as architecture. Her education is much wider with skills related to sustainable architecture, media architecture, and chaired training in CSG Harvard University. Her PG diploma theories is from Albagh University, Agra. Her practice, Manasaram Architects, is based in Bangalore and has since 1994, her architecture is distinguished for healing the biosphere and well-being of the society. Through use of sustainable material and technologies with emphasis on bamboo. Her work has been published widely and she also has been nominated for Afghan Award Architects for Architecture. She has a number of contributions in her architectural practice through bamboo. She has been awarded an ArchAsia Award for Architecture Rethinking the Future Award, and her work, Bamboo Symphony, her office is something very amazing, which I have personally come across through research and pictures. Also, she has a lot more achievement throughout the journey. Thank you, ma'am, for joining the event today. We are very grateful to have you in the presentation series. And with no further delay, I would like to hear it from you about your experiences with an attempt to cultivate nature in each of your interventions, working so hard against the mainstream to bring bamboo into people's imagination and show how important it is. I would like everyone of us who are here to give full attention to architect Neelam Manjunath. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you so much. And I heartily thank Anjum and Society of Nepalese Architects for this invite, which I am so happy to accept, and I'm really thankful that I'm able to interact with people outside the boundaries, which are as good as Indians to me. I mean, they're almost like our own brothers and sisters. So I hope I will be able to do justice to whatever expectations you all have. I'll start sharing my screen for my presentation, which... Just give me a moment. Yeah. So today I'll be actually sharing with you people my journey, though I am, as Hina was telling, more about the bamboo works, but they are the more known works of mine. But I would also try to tell you how I reached there and how, where I am going at the moment now in my journey as an architect. So, and the topic for today is, I mean, from last, I think last few years, I've been, had been thinking about, you know, the term architecture, which has seems to be being used by various professionals with so many prefixes, suffixes, ism and all these kind of things. I mean, and it really confuses me a lot. Because to me, as far as I understand, they all encompass architecture. That's what I had been thinking. So this is, at large. And in all this, I will tell you how this word simple living or simple architecture actually has come, you know, in the process of my learning and learning and relearning, actually. So this is, I through my school and my college days, I am from a middle-class family from Bihar in India. And educated in central school, Kendriya Vidyalaya, and government school. And then I went to college to Dayal Bagh, which is actually a spiritual place where we have the university, and I did my bachelor's with science, maths and physics out there. And then I joined this Government College of Architecture in Lucknow. My family actually has been a very religious kind of, you know, we had a very simple, frugal way of living. And that has had a very long, I mean, that very, very much impacted my philosophies towards life. I have never felt that I need too much. And I think that reflects in the way I also look at the things around me and the relationships. So when I joined the architecture college in Lucknow, and there were too many subjects which were being taught, which at that time really baffled as to why they are being taught. You had like sociology, and you had like economics, and you had geology. There were so many, you had climatology, and you had so many other subjects. And I was always trying to run into trying to understand the connection between all of them and to building design. I mean, how do they actually impact these subjects in during my architecture also, or any time when I have been studying, I always have been trying to relate it to. I also came across this Vastu Shastra in my second year. The climatology also was being taught at that time.
So ma'am was saying that she's running out of bandwidth. I think it's from her side. Let's wait for a while until she comes back. So I've been informed that she'll be back in a while. Let's get into a story of Neelam ma'am with her profound architectural journey in the field of bamboo architecture. And I would like to also describe some of her works, her affiliation, her education. So she has done BSc from RE College, Dayal Bagh, Agra, and she joined BE Architecture in 1982. In College of Architecture, Lucknow, she has done Diploma in Theology in 2009, as well as in 2010, she has done Media Architecture at Graduate School of Design, Harvard University. This I have also been describing in our introduction as well. So in professional experience, her practice called Mansuram Architects, which is based in Bangalore, was based in Delhi from 1991 to 1992, and 1 year in Nagpur, and now it's private practiced in Bangalore. She has been also board members and committees in Bamboo Society of India, Karnataka. She is also a member of ambassador of World Bamboo Organization and founder and CEO of Managing Center for Building Materials and Technology. She has also been chief jury for thesis in SET University, Ahmedabad as a Viva voice for Masters in Interior Architecture and Design. Now, talking about her works, she has done wide range of practice in residential, health, housing, community, institution, tourism, infrastructure, interior, as well as competitions. So let's go about residential practice of Architect Neelam ma'am. We are expecting Neelam ma'am to be here in a short period of time. Some of her famous work includes Metaslum, Cocoon for Krishi Vigyan Kendra, Bamboo Symphony, two-bedroom bamboo house at Ipritti, Bangalore State Level Energy Park, which is also in Bangalore, Police Bhavan for KSRP, prefabricated bamboo house in Italy. They have also used bamboo in several residential projects from single bedroom to a large 10,000 square feet of market house, such as including Five Elements, Tejpun Apartment and Aditi Greenscape E5 as many mass housing projects. Cocoon housing house plan is one of the distinguished projects that I have come across while I was going through the projects she has done so far. Her expertise includes the creation of exclusive bamboo buildings, designing sustainable structures of interiors, institution, landscape, leisure space, and urban design. With her passion and plan, she has brought a difference to create a sustainable society by promoting and amplifying in her projects the use of bamboo as one of the most versatile naturally available material, which consumes less energy, epitomizes sustainability, and is a better alternative to use of conventional material concrete, which acts as a catalyst to escalate the impact of global warming. Bamboo has fascinated her since her college days, as it was her core material all through her projects, and she used it distinctively in her every project. She faced several challenges in her 14 years of journey of promoting bamboos, but she stood strong and believed in contributing towards a sustainable environment by using naturally available material, and thus rural architecture became her forte. Her innovative use of bamboo in construction and a significant contribution to environmental, socio-economic durability and safety aspect brought her recognition in the field of architecture. She has prototyped a variety of building typologies with bamboo, ranging from something as small as low-cost bamboo toilet to an urban proposal for a metro station serving a wide spectrum of needs for all population. Architects Neelam's holistic approach to raising awareness about the material is not only limited through her projects, but also imparts knowledge through lecture in educational institutions and various courses to people at a different level of the construction workforce. She aims to run a course in over 200 centers across the country and set a benchmark in architecture through her journey of spreading the news of bamboo. Talking about her academic journey, she has also started a school of simple living back in 2020 from April by the implementation, by taking up issues concerning each elements of Panchatattva, which is five elements, the earth, fire, water, air, and space, through campaigns for advocacy, through the courses, talks, projects, and so on, which can also be seen in her website about the School of Simple Living. People come and join for courses.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I think there was some problem with the Zoom actually, because I had the signal, but anyway, okay, I will just start again.
Yes, we were waiting for you.
Yeah, I know. I don't know how it is gone. Okay, you can see now?
Yes, I can see your screen now.
Yeah. Yes, okay. So I have worked with this, I'm extremely sorry for the break, thanks to technology glitches. And I have worked with, actually when I finished my architecture, I directly went to Mr. Architect Ravindra Bhan, who is actually the first Asian architect who has done his landscape design, and he had his practice. And I worked, and I thought that, you know, architecture has to connect to nature. And I thought he was one person who will teach me how to connect to nature. And that is how I have worked on the Shakti Stal project and many other projects, which I, you know, eco-restoration of Himalayas, eco-restoration of Sundarbans in West Bengal. And I learned how to connect my projects, my buildings seamlessly to architecture. He also taught us how to landscape with nature, not landscape like a landscaping with nature, not just with plants and trees to be planted in the this thing. And the other architect that I worked with was Jasbir Sahani and Associates, where I worked on this large HUDCO project. I'm really happy. This was supposed to be for the Afro-Asian Games Village. And we were three architects who were given the responsibility of designing this total project. We didn't do the whole thing, but most of it was done by us. And after that, I had some small these things, and then I started my own practice in 1991. So now from there onwards, I will just share to you, this was what my education and, you know, working with my other masters with whom I worked. And Jasbir Sahani at that time was the only architect probably in the country who was using a lot of AutoCAD and systems and doing things in a different manner. So I learned different things from different masters, and I started my practice. And while I started my practice, I'm sharing with you how I understand architecture now after all this education that shaped me there. So this is for me like you start with the beginning of the universe, and this is how life came, the early lives form that came to the earth, and you know, it started from water and then it came to land. And then the humans arrived much later and they started forming a way of life. And fire was one of the greatest invention, as you all know, and it really changed their life a lot. You know, they could use fire for you know, scaring away the wild animals and protecting themselves in the night. Also, they could you know, they could put the fire, and this was one invention that they really. And then once they had that, they started making shelters. Yeah, the earliest forms that you can see here, some the top right one is from Spain. I think that's the earliest art forms that anyone could you know. So once they started living in caves, they had much more safety, and they were not always worried about the elements and the wild animals and other things. So they had little more time to think. And that's when all these artworks and these things slowly it started the form, you can say the beginning of culture. And then man started doing different kinds of shelters because he started to do some kind of agriculture. I think it was more in the form of jhum cultivation at that time. They would burn and they would cut and all, and they'll do agriculture. And then they used to move from one place to another. So the shelters also, what they made was made from the things which were locally available to them and which could be easily dismantled and which could be easily again carried you know, with them. These are the people who were more in the living in the pastures and the in and around you know, a river or a water body where they could actually do agriculture. So this is as you can see here, the people actually started using the stone axe to form shapes and do different kinds of shelters with all the available material. And on the right hand side, what you see bottom is like probably one of the earliest prefab structures that man made with only a roof and a wall, which could actually I have seen this kind of you know, this kind of shelters even now in several parts of the country, in our parts of the country. These were appropriate shelters, and they were made as per the climate and as per the local materials that they could find around them. And they were also suited for the purpose for which it was there. So they had very simple way of life, you know, so they had just one room and this was a shelter, and that's how they made it with whatever material they could get. So you had to get safety, you had to get a place to stay where you could, you will not catch cold or you will not feel the heat. And you also will not be attacked by the wild animals and attacked by other tribes or other groups. So that was the purpose of a shelter with which they actually would make. And then we had the earlier civilization of the world. As you can see, they all made from local materials that was available to them. And the climate, all of them are adjusted to the climate that they were actually built in. These were two main factors actually, which you know, which actually runs across all these traditional buildings and all the earlier civilizations. Now, this seven wonders of the world, as you can see, they all have been, they are different parts of the world. They represent absolutely different kind of you know, cultures, and that is again the culture grew. In response to the local requirement of climate and people's belief and things like that. So they were quite different from each other. And then, you know, at that time, slowly, there was no architect, something like that, but they had something like a sculptor and an engineer so he was supposed to be both, because there was no engineer separate. So a person who would build a building had to think about the structure and the aesthetic all at the same time. So the function would not be just to, you know, use of space, but also practical, aesthetic, psychological, and also cultural. So it actually functioned in all the manner. And this was done by one person who would be the, you know, person who would build the, you know. And then slowly these ancient buildings, as you can see, from different parts of the world, again, very, very different from each other. For their beliefs, again, for their how the climate has been there and how had been there, they all, whatever their requirements were there as per that they were building. And then came something called the modern architecture. After World War I and then subsequently after World War II, we had different kinds of movements that were there where they started looking at the common man and stripping all the kind of, you know, lot of like a frugal kind of architecture that they were looking at. And so the building wanted to display the functional and structural elements. And this is what they started. You had the Bauhaus movement, and you had all other buildings that came up during that time. Now, this all has led to something what we call now as global architecture. Now, on the left side, what you see, the two buildings, these are both from Australia. I do not know. They could be anywhere in the world, actually. You cannot just tell that these are from a particular part of the world. I mean, from where we started and from where we have reached. And on the right side, what you look at is something called the definition of development, the Manhattan skyline. So whenever somebody says, oh, everyone wants to go to America and everyone wants to live the life, you know, the way, and every city wants to become something like Manhattan, has to have a skyline like Manhattan. This is became the definition of development. So from where we had started and from where we have reached, and this urbanization, all this thing has brought a lot of urbanization. So as you saw in the beginning, when we said, okay, the people gathered at one place, they were living at one place, they were trying to take care of their basic necessities. It was called a human settlement with a higher population density and infrastructure of built environment. But slowly as the, you know, urbanization or, you know, it became two cities, a favorable environment for human capital development also has got generated simultaneously. And that's where these things can, these are the kind of, the definition of development started coming. And people started moving from rural areas and other areas to the cities. The population division of the United States, as you can see, predicted that the population would grow to 6.4 billion by 2050, with 37% of that growth to come from three countries, China, India, and Nigeria. This is a really a worrying figure. Why do we, and if you see around everywhere, we have this lot of conferences and seminars and programs happening, something called Smart City and you know, all these Smart City programs. What is actually all this? Why do we always have to have these urban problems to be solved? Why we cannot de-urbanize our centers? It will automatically solve many of the problems that we actually have. I think de-urbanization is something which probably have to be seriously thought of, especially now that the situation that has come, this is the last year. All events happened last year. We all know in Australia and, you know, in Bengal and, you know, all these that, you know, the Amphan, what it came, all this came here last year. But there was no reaction, you know. When something is happening in Australia or in India, we think, okay, it's happening in Australia. And we are really not, you know, concerned with that. But when it came to this, that's when people started realizing that, you know, we can't really sit quiet. This is absolutely at your doorstep. And all that we have been doing and talking about development, urbanization has actually caused this. This has been a wake-up call, especially last year. And this has happened, as we all know, that zoonotic diseases, which has been the cause for our COVID, actually is because we have, you know, tampered with our biodiversity. We have a lot of, you know, species which are disappearing, which are becoming extinct. And so we are directly now, there's no barrier between us and the wildlife and other systems that were there, biodiversity systems, extreme biodiversity systems that were there. So we are directly exposed to it, and there's no way that we can actually now, not look at it directly into the eye. We have to have, we have to really wake up and understand what we are supposed to do. Some of the work which has been happening in the past is about sustainable and green buildings and site-responsive architecture, which is organic architecture. But more of it has, again, sustainability has become the most abused words probably across the world. everything you do, everything, and then you call it sustainable in one way or the other, and you try to define it, you try to justify it. But there are people who are actually, because I think now that all these things have happened, there are sustainable communities which are being developed across the world, and these are some of the things that everyone is looking at, excessive and wasteful use and things like that. This is happening across the world, but the number is very, very small. And in this scenario, I would like to, what I just showed it to you, I tried to understand, and this is what is my design statement, which I thought as an architect, I have to be a catalyst to provide the social and cultural stage sets for all the human activities. As an architect, that's what we are supposed to do. And hence the magnitude of responsibility on our shoulders is of staggering proportion. We cannot just design buildings for the heck of it, or for the, you know, for the, you get a kick out of designing a certain kind of putting a different kind of a color or something like that. We have to have a responsible and creativity. There are two terms. So some projects and will have more of responsible kind of a thing when you're talking about EWS housing and things like that. And there will be other kinds of things when you have a creative responsibility when you are doing with something like cultural spaces and things like that. But you still have a responsibility in that you cannot go overboard trying to think that again, you can do a lot of whatever you want. So you really have to restrict yourself between these two terms. You have to be creative because it has to be appealing, but at the same time, you also have to be responsible. And that should actually determine the architecture character of any building. This has been the underlying principle of most of my projects. And this is, I think, sustainability we all know. So I would not go in detail in that. But this is something which I would have, man always has been thinking that there's man and there's nature and there's technology, which is a wrong model. Actually, man is within the building and the building is within nature and the nature is you know, within the universe, the total universe. And so sustainability actually is the real definition of architecture. We don't need to define it. It's just that we have actually forgotten the thing about parametric architecture. Architecture was always parametric. You had several parameters which you were supposed to take care, which people were not taking care. And that's why this, now that has been given to the software to solve. But in case you do not know exactly what parameters you are supposed to be actually looking at and what switch you are supposed to put, your design response could be completely off the mark. And that is completely dangerous. So if you have the software in the hands of somebody who does not know the meaning of all the parameters, what effect that parameter actually can have on the building, then you are a gone case. I mean, your design is absolutely gone. So we really have to you understand. And nature, you know, keeps reminding us actually of our true identity all the time. That, you know, you are supposed to be a caretaker and not the owner. So don't exploit. You're supposed to go along with it. And that is what we have been trying to, I have been trying to follow. And this is something which is very close to my heart. This is a Native American saying by the chief of Seattle, that you can't actually buy and sell. I think all of you might have really heard this particular, you know, it's actually a part of a letter that he wrote to the American president when they asked that, you know, they want to buy the Seattle land. And these Indians in, you know, they told, this was the answer that was the chief of the, you know, tribe wrote to him. That each part of the earth is sacred to us. You know, what befalls the earth, we all are one. I mean, only after the last tree has been cut and only after the last fish has been caught. So this is one principle that I actually follow in my, I always keep thinking about it whenever I'm designing something, how to actually take care of those things. And so nature is the key, according to me. And we have to take care of the three faculties of man, which is like, it's not the only the physical requirement that we are supposed to look at. We also are supposed to look at psychological and spiritual requirement. And spiritual is not meaning about doing puja or anything like that. It's about being equitable to another person in the society, treating the resources in an equitable manner. That is what is spiritual to me. And as we all know, nature is low energy and cyclic. And this is one principle again, I try to follow to do my my architecture in the lowest energy possible and try to be as cyclic as possible. As we all know, there's nothing originally man-made. We have got everything, from nature. As you can see, the flower, and then you can have a slightly less processed building, which is made of earth and, you know, other materials. And you have a highly processed building, but that also comes from nature. The only difference is the processing that is done by various people to think that, you know, the civilization, higher the civilization and probably more processed a product you should have, you know, highly finished and things like that. And people think that whatever is natural is actually not processed and not actually defined, which is again a very, very wrong perception. Now, in this whole scenario, if we have to build buildings, now how do we actually be low energy and still be cyclic? And that is again brings me to the elements which I have been toying at right from the beginning, the five elements. I always try to see that I have these five elements actually felt by my client in the buildings that I design. So we have to connect to them. Why? And why is that so? See, I have a very simple example to say. Suppose you are stressed, you know, where do you actually go? You actually go to a park where you connect to air, you connect to, you know, the elements around you. You don't go and shut yourself in a room because that will further get you more stressed. So it is in our DNA, and we are all in balance. The five elements in our body or in nature is in balance. So when you go out there in the nature, it balances you. So you don't go out to the nature all the time. You are in a building. So how do we bring that part, you know, the five elements inside the building? Is the quest, again, it's a very difficult task, but I think that's very important also to achieve when you are trying to build a building which you want the people to really live peacefully. So the focus from development is on environment, and that's what I say, it's not just you get a degree and you get productive and in growth. You also are supposed to look at equity, and you're supposed to also look at, you know, all the other things. And so the development, sustainable development, whether we are talking about a village or a city or a building, we always have to have leaving no one behind. The spectrum has to be much larger than, and of course, that's what I meant, parametric. It has to be parametric. So this brings me to the topic that I had put, the architecture with elements for simple living. And why I'm going on emphasizing about simple living is when you're living simply, you actually are spiritual. And when you are spiritual, you actually are sustainable by default. So when you define space, design spaces which fulfill the basic needs of a shelter to perform various activities, it actually performs the function and it actually will be in balance with elements, and it will be for simple living. And this is what I have been trying to achieve. And these are some of the, again, simple and direct solutions, as I said. And so with all this, I have not been simply doing building design right from the beginning. I have been trying to organize, and I've been trying to interact with various people, trying to, the left top photograph is from the Harvard University club, where I had gone to attend these two programs on charrette training and media architecture. And charrette training is one something, I do not know how many people know about it. A charrette is something when you involve a community to find a solution to a project. So suppose you have a development project, you try to get all the stakeholders together and you try to find their needs, the needs that they have, so that they have a voice. And what it does actually is that, you know, it resolves a lot of conflicts which might come in the project in the later years. So when you're trying to work with the community feels involved, it owns the project by itself. So in that way, as an architect, as a planner, you have an easier way, and authorities also have a better, access, and the people have better access to the authorities. So your project goes in a little better manner. And this was something which I thought was very important, because I also always wanted to involve the community in most of my projects. And I did all these training programs and workshops, which I have been doing across advocacy through, publishing and things like that. And so I will just quickly go to the earlier practice of 1991. These are very, you may be surprised, I never thought of actually documenting any of my buildings before I started working with bamboo. I do not know why it never struck me. And many of the buildings I have not been able to even you know, get the final photographs and things like that, and I have not been able to visit. And not that, I mean, once we finished and then we visited, after that we have not been able to visit. The thing was, you know, like, I thought I have done my job, and it's only when I started working with Bamboo, I have been, many of my projects, you know, these are some of the projects that I've done. I've done a lot of Ashray housing, around 25,000 houses with the Rajiv Gandhi Rural Housing Corporation. And these were like 40,000 Indian rupees houses. But even for these, I had lot of sarets, as I would say, with the people that were around there, and gave them solutions for incremental housing. And this was in the year, I would say 2008-2009, when I did this with them, and they were very successful, because people got involved and they really felt that they are actually doing the housing themselves. And as you can see, this is another farmhouse. It's not the farmhouse, which is like about the luxury, but this was about doing with whatever available materials you have nearby. And I was playing with materials all the time, as you can see, even the construction systems and use of materials, use of waste, and different kind of arches and different kinds of, you know, material used in a different manner. This was something which I have always enjoyed, and trying to bring the color of natural material, my natural color of the materials into my spaces and in the buildings. I hardly ever color my buildings actually much. We did many hospitals in that time, in that particular period, and how there were large hospitals with housings and all the other facilities and all that. We did about 4 to 5 hospitals and in that era. And this was one project, quite a large project, but somehow, unfortunately, it did not go through later. We even had the Bhumi Puja, and the work started on the site. After that, the airport authority took over. This was a 5-star deluxe hotel with the largest glass dome at that time. This was also around 1998-99, when I had designed, and we had the Guardian Glass people come from USA, and they sent their samples, and we had the meetings. Unfortunately, this project, this was supposed to be one of the quite a big project that we were actually into at that time. And then in 1999, this Bamboo Connection came, and I got a very small project, which is in the Raj Bhavan, to make a pantry. And it was like just about in about 3 weeks or 4 weeks time, we finished this whole structure. It was an old school, and we recycled most of the material and added some bamboo to it. And this is how the build. And my whole office was there, including a MTech person, structure guy, and myself, and all our people, and doing things all by ourselves almost. And this particularly actually changed my whole perception about the way architecture should be done, and the way things should be done, and about the material also. So one material in my hand, which I could mold the way I wanted. And I really felt a lot of freedom, with this material in my hand. This project that you see on the right is an exhibition hall. This is again a semi prefabricated structure, which we fabricated in Bangalore and took it to Chennai, Madras, I mean, and we built it there. It is a little different from what we did here, because there the thing is saline. And this is something which I have been trying to take care, and I would be coming to that little more even later, that when you're working with materials which are natural, something like bamboo and mud, you really need to be very careful about how you treat them. And it has to be particularly as per the climate. If you don't, then it can be a disaster. This was a 2-bedroom house again given to me by the Plywood Institute, and it has been a landmark project for us. The 2-bedroom house, and it was supposed to connect to the urban people, that they can have bamboo as a as a material, as an alternative to other materials in the city, in the urban areas. And actually, I think it has really sparked a lot of interest, and it's still there. It is very well functioning, very well. Almost, this was in 2002-2003, and working really well. This is their clubhouse now. And these are some of the interior photographs of this particular building, with different kinds of, have bamboo ply, you have bamboo roofing sheets, and you had bamboo, and you had bamboo crete wall. These are the things that they had actually developed in Plywood Institute, and they wanted it to be incorporated in a building. This I will go a little faster because there are too many still. The EW has asked, there are a lot of projects we did in that time. But as you can see in all of these, I was combining bamboo with other materials to make it mainstream. And I have a lot of projects, a lot of photographs of these projects because there was no documentation of any work on bamboo before. If I would want to find anything, I could not find anything. And so it was like me and anyone, if I would go, they would ask me, why should have I, can you show me somewhere else where you have this kind of building is done? And I had nowhere to show. So when I was doing it, I said, okay, let me just take a lot of pictures and a lot of, database, create a database, which can be used by people behind me to actually work on the material later. And that's why you generally find a lot of most of these photographs on my website or on my, these things are with buildings with bamboo. That is one of the main reasons. It's not that I don't do other kind of architecture. So that is how it is. As I showed, I was doing housing, but nobody actually has, it has not really got highlighted because I have not gone back again and taken photographs of those projects. This is another project which we did, and we got a national award for this. This was a school. And again, you can see very different kind of materials. We use terracotta blocks, we use stone. We use different kind of materials here. And this was for the children. And this was for the social welfare ministry. Children never used to come to school, so I was supposed to make it very interesting. So all classrooms are in different geometrical shapes, and you have a veranda where they could run and swing and all those kind of things. So they were incorporated, as you can see, the children, when I visited next, this is how they greeted me with a salute, and that was the most rewarding award, I think, an architect can think of. This is a state level energy park we did in 2005. And this was also awarded a national award. And here it was supposed to be a state level energy park. So I thought they asked me to do a building to showcase the solar PV and all those solar systems and energy systems like that. So I said, okay, bamboo is a low energy material. So let me use bamboo completely in this particular project. And that's how you can see everything is made out of bamboo here. And this is, some other, gazebos and all other options that I did. I used bamboo left, right, and center for different kind of thing to really, on the right side, what you see on the top is actually the change room with a curved wall in this one. This was a different vocabulary for MNC cafeteria. And then this label of the bamboo architect just got stuck to me. And I had a lot of problem finding projects of other types. It became very difficult. And the bamboo-based projects, also were something like you have gazebos and you have these small projects. Because I finished all the projects which I had started with, and the new projects, because of the label of the bamboo architect, it was really difficult for me. I completely almost lost my practice. This security shed is a small fellow, but this is in Dialbagh University, Agra, and this was made as a proof of concept for starting courses on bamboo. This time I realized that unless and until I have these structured courses, for skilling and education, we will not have people, and this material actually cannot be taken forward. So this was the year 2005, 2006 when I did this, and I'm very happy to say that we are doing courses with Dialbagh University, modular courses, and we from CGBMT is running some postgraduate courses as well. These are the different events which we are invited to because bamboo was exciting everybody. And so this was the interior exterior exhibition in which we were. And then came this 24th December, the big tsunami that happened. This is a prototype that we did with bamboo and local wood and here and there, out there. Now, unfortunately, this was not taken up by the Planning Commission in India. They were trying to push industrial products for walling. And, it's like, it was very disheartening because this was something which we trained the, people, and they made it themselves. So this should have given them a livelihood security, because after any kind of disaster. It is not that you have to give them houses. You also have to, give them livelihood security, for them to start a new life, which somehow, unfortunately, did not happen. This was a housing project that we have done with Karnataka Housing Board. It's around almost 50 acres of land, and this one. In 2006-2007, we did this project, Yamuna Biodiversity Park, and this bridge is still there, though slightly without, because of no maintenance, it is slightly bent and things, and they have asked us to either replace or repair it, but it is very much there. There are some other, structures that we did there. And if you see the change in how I started treating bamboo and how I'm using bamboo in the building, the structural systems are kept on changing from one to the other. You see the bottom of this bridge here, there's one single bamboo which is taking the load and it is connecting the bridge together. And I think all this actually tells about the, the properties of the material, if it's properly used, I mean, how it actually can contribute to most of our building works. This is one competition that we were runners up in this, but later it got stalled. So this was a shell. And I started working at shell out of bamboo because it's such a light material, and I thought this would be the best material to use for shells. This is a bamboo museum in Palampur. This is, I think, the only bamboo museum in the country, India. And we did it with S.D. Sharma and Associates. They were the architects and we were the bamboo experts, and all these designs and drawings were done by us for them. Then we have these other houses now. By this time, I further went ahead and I understood that mainstreaming bamboo and is only possible if you completely combine it like any other building material. So I started using it with mud and a stone, and trying to find a solution or a vocabulary as to how to have a new vocabulary with all the sustainable materials, local materials. Now, mud you find everywhere on every side. Bamboo generally in our part of the country and our part of the world, we always have a bamboo bazaar or a bamboo depot, and stone and waste, of course, that's another new material that we have. So these are the materials with which I started looking at defining a new vocabulary. And what better project for an architect but their own house? So this is my own house of five elements, where I tried to put all these principles that I have been talking about so far. This is made of mud and stone and bamboo, all three probably in the, and as you can see, the building does not compromise in any manner on any of the amenities actually for the of modern living or urban setting. With bamboo, we have been able to use provide and have all these kind of different spaces. What you see at the background there is a bamboo bridge, and with only 1.5 inch bamboo, and it takes my load, so you can understand. This is the first floor, which is completely, it's a shell roof of 4,000 square feet and completely put on bamboo. It's a double curve shell roof. And this is bamboo flooring in this thing. So bamboo has been used with mud. All that is wall is mud. The roof is also mud. The slab is also made of mud blocks. So there's a use of all these materials that is that has created a very different kind of architecture. And in the left photograph, what you see is those walls. They are bamboo-crete walls with columns in between. Here's some other shots of the house, as you can see. And this is immediately after finishing my house, I had a lot of materials which were left over. And I did my office with that. This is a bamboo symphony. And a very different kind of principles. I was looking at the fishing platforms, traditional fishing platforms, and how they really take almost like 50 tons load, and all these kind of so much of fish loads on a single bamboo pole. And that really intrigued me as to how to, so the structure that I have done for my office is based on those principles. And as you can see here, these are like a riot of different kind of bamboo poles in different form, different directions, And these are all structural elements. There's no interior. I don't do interiors of my buildings generally. They are very, very basic. And most of them derive their colors and their finishes from directly from the building. So what you see here is actually all structural elements. And this is where I sit and where I'm sitting right now, you can see. That's a 15 feet clear span with bamboo out there. So this was something which actually gave me a lot of confidence. So that is, that was actually a free form roof. First I did a shell and then it's a free form roof. This is reinforced with bamboo splits. And the concrete that I have here also has bamboo fibers, which has been added in the aspect ratio. So you have bamboo fiber reinforced concrete, which was used for the roof of this particular building. So these were like, I kept on innovating, I mean, on my own and experimenting on my own and in all the buildings that I have been doing. And as you can see, you know, it was really the label of bamboo architect really was really started getting me down. And, you know, like it was something which was not work, because I had thought, if I am not mainstream and I am not having projects of that kind, how do I mainstream bamboo? So it has to be done in a proper manner. So that's how I started working, you know, further in this. So and of course, I think there was a cusp that was there. And of course, then I things have been much better since that time, since after I have finished my house and all. And this is a apartment building in the same complex, about 16 apartments. And this has got the very different principles. I have always been a lot on ventilation and lighting, very particular about it. And this is another house that we did for Mr. Sriram. And as you can see, the vocabulary is again with mud and stone and bamboo, all combined, and a lot of greenery, of course, a lot of greenery around. And these are some of the projects that are still, that they're under process with the government. This is with Gujarat government for a cafeteria. This is a guest house that we did in about 19 days, right from hitting the ground to completely finishing it with all solar tracking devices and all furniture. This was something, a massive exercise with about 100 people working on different sectors, and I was working with them simultaneously. So as you can see, even the bathroom has got this countertop, which is made with you know, this. Bamboo, and we have the top that we have is actually made of bamboo crete top, and we casted it and we have put it out there, and you can see all this. This was another project in Trichy, which is a workshop project, a Sarit project again, and where we had students and we had faculty from from a foreign university and Denmark, and we had Care College Trichy and our CGBMT. We tried to work out a solution for this. They had this made this kind of a form of cocoon which they could not actually execute, and then we were called, and so we did the structural design of this and the typology of the building, and we use Arcanet plates as shingles, as roof shingles for this one. This also has been, last year it was shortlisted in the FIBRA Awards, and it has been going on the international traveling exhibition. It is even now, it is in the exhibition. Contrasting to that, I have this one, temple that I am doing, and this has been going on for last 10 years actually, because the contributions come very late. This is our proposal for metro stations for Bangalore, and due to fire audit issues, they had not cleared it. They said this is under process, but we have not heard from them. But suddenly what you hear here is that in Bangalore, Bangalore Airport Terminal 2, the new terminal is being built, and it has got lot of bamboo. So after Madrid Airport, where Richard Rogers had used bamboo for the false roofing, here also SOM, they are using bamboo. And believe it or not, the use of bamboo for their consultation, it had come to me They had come to me through the World Bamboo Organization. They consulted me for 2 to 3 months. After that, they never got back. They told me they have to make the presentation to the client. So I helped them with all the properties and all the other things as to how they had sent me drawings of their, wherever they wanted to use the bamboo. And based on that, I had actually advised them. And that has got approved, so I'm hoping that this metro station also someday, at least one of the options will get approved. So this third option, as you can see, it's a complete shell of bamboo in with a weaving thing, making its own, it's like a bamboo composite, bamboo woven bamboo composite. The structure of the building is what I have designed. And I just hope someday, very quickly or some shortly, I will be able to put it back, execution. This is another project which we did with limestone actually in Hungary. And this was a part of a competition. And you can see they don't have big bamboos. They have very thin bamboos. And they have that, they use that for the flute. So this since it was supposed to be a house of music, so this is what I used it there with limestone and with other materials that they have been using. These are some of the infrastructure small projects, and I mean, if I keep on going in detail, there'll be a lot of time that will be required to really finish it. These are some bamboo centers we have been doing for the Aalborg University, has been going in a big way. And we are doing, when this is under construction, this conference halls right now. And these are the 3D views, as you can see. This is another one. This is a creche that they had asked, and we have, this was finished in 2017, 2018, 19. And local bamboo has been used for this, and children really love it, and this is uses, as you can see, the woman, he's using the traditional system of using mud on bamboo. The walls are made with that. This is another hospital that we had done. This is another big project which we are hoping to start pretty soon. And this we got through a tender. And this is about a crafts village complex where we are trying to bring the craft of buildings making, because earlier the buildings were also made as crafts, that into the architecture of the project. So this is something with rammed earth and trying to take technology in the longer. So this is a shell roof on a rammed earth construction, and there are many other features that we are going to do in this. It's another project where supposed to be doing the tallest tower and the longest skywalk and the biggest conference hall of about 30,000 square feet. This is also right now going on, but very slowly, thanks to COVID and thanks to the Andhra Pradesh government elections. And this is Hyderabad, a similar kind of farm project, going again one by one. This is another very ambitious project of mine with soil and bamboo as for multiple shell that I had tried to use, and use the local know-how and the local mud in there and the culture to do this project. This is Manipur in 2019. We had done in 7 days' time. We were supposed to do a pavilion, and this is our project there. Again, this uses a very different kind of roofing solution with jute, with lime, cement slurry and lime. I'm just going to end this with this last project. This is my last project that I want to show. All these things I've been trying to put in my principle in this particular project. This is a housing for 100 housing project. And the front part, that lower part you see, is where my office and house is. And the other part, you already saw one Tej Punj apartment. The other parts are all this. And this, we got the Rethinking Award for this also. And the principle that we have been using is when the last tree has been cut. So how do you bring this into actual practice? Nature never wastes. We are talking about it. So how do you really bring it? So trying to work out the project intent, harmony with nature, community living, embrace. Because doing one house is okay. Your own house is okay. But when you are trying to design a project which is on a commercial scale and you're also supposed to sell it, how do you really make it appealing at the same time? Following all these principles. So there were a lot of principles that we have followed. That we are, it is not like a project, it's like a building community and socially responsible architecture. So there is a wellness center, the kind of facilities that we are trying to give. And another principle was, you know, like this is 4 acre and I have 1 acre as park, which is something which people really don't have. And I already have grown trees in this from 2006. So they are fully grown trees on this project already, you know. So this is like a city in a park versus park in a city. So you don't actually design parks, you know, you have to live in nature, means you have to have trees for 5 senses, evergreen, color, fragrance, fruit, size, volume. So there are so many principles that I had been working at. I have put it in this particular project. And these are various, different forms, materials, and energy systems. So it's absolutely at the this thing of using both technology to its cutting edge at the same time, taking nature to its extreme. So as much as you take it from nature as a built up area, you give at least more than that in the form of greenery, in the form of, other. So, and harvest all that nature gives you freely on your site. This is the green data. Something is, we really need to have this and, think about it in all our projects. What is our green plot ratio? What is our community plot ratio? Are we giving enough community facilities? Then our ecosystem contribution index, the landscape that we are putting, is it actually contributing to the ecosystem or not, or they are just show trees? And then self-sufficiency index in terms of energy and food and water. So these are some principles, again, how I have put the 5 elements in there: usage of seamless high ceiling spaces, harnessing maximum daylight to indoors, water bodies, trees, natural building materials. And this is environmental integration. How do you actually do that? And different kinds of, the way the spaces have been organized. There's greenery all around, but still you have your privacy. And how do you actually ensure that? And then is a vertical living actually a compromise over an independent house? So these are vertical villas that we have actually designed. So there's a core, and there's all the island apartments, they're all connected by bridges. And so these are some of the views. This is the LEED rating system. We have 87 points. We had targeted for 92. We got 87 points. And these are some of the 3Ds. This is the community center. We don't call it a clubhouse. And we have this inside the apartments. It is like this. It is going to be like this. Is almost there. These are the ways. And this is the construction stage that it is in right now. The apartments are done and the villas are being done. And this is what you see. Yeah, the finishing stage. As you can see from the apartment inside, you can see the whole park complete with greenery right now. And there was one question, I think, that was put here. So what am I trying to do to the students? This is what I'm trying to do. I'll just take another 2 minutes. CGBMT School of Simple Living is something which we have started last year on our foundation day on 26th April. And through this, what we are trying to do and tell people is that nature is the solution. So we are going to have these 5 faculties, which is of 5 elements, fire, space, water, earth, and air. And we are trying to have sustainable technologies, skilling, and education in through these faculties. And so how and why it is like that, that you want to enable every human being to acquire the knowledge and skills and attitudes and values necessary to shape a sustainable future. And how do you do it? So, that is what we are telling, that the pedagogy for architecture for simple living should be in a way where you have an interdisciplinary learning, in cross-sectional learning, with different kind of people, different strata of people, and only then we can actually think about, we are doing an advocacy campaign for the last 1 year, which is called Simple Living. And we have been posting posts every day from 26th April last year till now. And we are doing these simple talks on water and themes like that. As you can see, Rajendra Prasad Singh, we have had Dr. Vandana Shiva on our panel. We had so many other distinguished people who have been coming. This is a collaborative project that we had started, and incidentally, it was started just before the COVID, And the relevance of it actually came to us, it hit us. So on 2nd March, we had our advisory committee meeting in which we passed this, that we'll be doing this collaborative project with other architects, other NGOs, other colleges across the world. And how do we have these policy frameworks for mass gathering and religious festivals? And how do we stop the degradation and the, you know, or overloading in biodiversity hotspots? So we'll be very happy to have people, if they want to collaborate with us on this, we'll be, and this is our logo, which actually sums up what we are thinking. So we all connected. Man is inside nature, and all our veins, all our blood vessels, all our this thing, everything is nature. So man is nature, man is nature. And that is how we are supposed to actually do our projects. So this is something which I, this is my presentation. And so I would stop share here. Yeah. Yeah, Hina, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your wonderful presentation that gave us a great insight in your practice, philosophies. It is such an honor to have you in our platform today. And I'm certain that our viewers have taken back much value from your inspiring work. The project was very inspiring to see how beautifully you have crafted and put into thoughts, not only that, but in a world and a time where everyone strives to make things look complex and competitive, your project has made me realize how important it is to see things in a simple way possible. And with that, your school called School of Simple Living has also given the same idea, as not everyone begins with the idea of simple things, simple fact, and simple lessons for simple living to put force into a common man in the simplest way. And I'm certain that we can also learn, unlearn, and relearn many things from today's presentation. So let me also inform to our viewers that they can put questions in the question answer box. Let's see how much questions we have got. Meanwhile, to continue our series, I would also like to know, is there any project that resonates with you quite well, which is very special to you? I mean, every project for an architect is very special. It's like a baby for us, since we are involved from ground to the completion. But I would like generally like to know that if you have some special things that resonates you, maybe it can be residence. But yeah, the project that you've been describing about your residence, which gave a very great insight of your philosophies from offices and residence, was very nice.
Actually, I involve myself in every project, and I'm too much involved in all of them. So most of them, I really feel very strongly about my projects. And that is there. But my house and my office was very special because I had the freedom to completely do what I wanted. But at the same time, I had to be very responsible. Not that I'm not responsible in other ones, but I could understand the other person's point of view. Like, I had to think what my son would think. I had to think what my husband would react to. I had to think whether my daughter is going to really like it or not. And because it's a house, it's going to be there for a long time. And most of all, you may not believe it, the roof that I have put there was a very big challenge. But that was put in 2008, and a shell roof with bamboo, I don't think many people have done in the world at that time. And I had one, reference of Shoyo, who had done a school, you know, like a hanky. And I kept on looking for his, to speak to him or get a mail ID, and I could not get. So I had to do everything myself. So I did the roof, but 2 years I could not sleep. What if the roof comes down? It's like, and we didn't have enough money, because the house looks too big, But there are a lot of verandas and there are a lot of terraces that makes it look very big. So this whole volume inside is actually under that 4,000 square feet roof that comes in between, which where I have my courtyard and I have my living spaces. And it was like, it has stood, this is now like 12 years now. And we have finished bamboo only twice, I think. I mean, the painting and polishing and all that. I mean, it's not that like every year we have to do something like that and it has survived. But at that time, the side finishing were not there. So there would be a lot of breeze and there would be a lot of something. And they would say, oh, I hope the roof stays. It was something like that. So that, but that taught me a lot about how to react to client and be much more responsive to, and not responsive, I would say, accept the comments that the clients give. How do you actually incorporate that without compromising on the values that you want to put forth in your project? So that was something, was a very big lesson to me. And my office was like, they are like, the more the pain, the more the ecstasy after you have done it. So I am I love free forms. I love free forms. And I feel I can do large free forms with bamboo. And then this was something like I did a free form. And I wanted to put bamboo for reinforcement. I wanted to put bamboo fiber. I thought it would work instead of plastic fibers. And I put it there as per the aspect ratio. But the amount of learning that I had in that period, because I had to explore everything myself. And it was my house. And, I really wanted to do, all keystone species for my landscape. I wanted a lot of birds and bees around me. I wanted an ecosystem developed, a water body developed. So there was so much learning in that 2 to 3 years of time. It was a very exciting time that way for me. So even in when you see, I have used mud, soil cement blocks, but people till that time, they were not having big windows in a soil cement block houses, which is like in the contemporary structure, contemporary buildings, everyone wants a large window and large opening. And then how do you find a solution to that? So we actually designed with Dr. Yogananda, who is here in Bangalore and thankfully based in Bangalore. He was very cooperative. He was a consultant for soil, the mud blocks. And he taught me how to design your own walls with different. So every wall was designed separately as per the size of the opening and the kind of opening that I had. And the stabilization would depend on that. You stabilize the mud before, modify the mud before you make it into a block. And that was taught by him. So all these kind of, and so from then onwards, people have started putting bigger windows in soil cement blocks houses. Otherwise, nobody was putting it. It was like 3 feet would be the maximum. So nobody wanted to use it for a modern kind of a house, as they would say. So I said, let me break that barrier. So I have broken hundreds of barriers in my office and in my house, and that's why it is it is very special and very exciting. And I think still there are many more things that I would like to do in them, which I keep on thinking, and I just hope I'll be able to do that further. Yes.
Well, that's a very profound idea, and I do think it takes experience like yours to think about all these factors. And nowadays, the architects in today's practice should be comprehensive to the users also, which also gave a very good example from your own residence building, that even while designing things, you thought of so many people, your own family members, if they like it or not. So these all factors are also carrying forward in the future for practitioners as well. We have one question. So yeah, often in the field of architects are hurried by the demand of commercial practice. So how does one engage in the conversation about the slow and unhurried process of the design? Or let's say, your project is also sort of meditative process where you kind of gel things with bamboo and concrete mud. So how do you even engage people about this conversation of slow and unhurried process?
Actually, it need not be always very slow, but yeah, as an architect, we need to supervise it more. That's where the thing happens. So our engagement in the projects is much higher in these kind of projects, and it should be. That's what I'm saying. Everyone seems to be in a hurry. Everyone seems to be trying to find very complex things and trying to complicate things. And so there you're trying to pull people towards, take a breath, think about it, whether you really want it like this or you want it a little different. And which will give you a much longer, better ambience, because that you are not able to really appreciate right now. As I will tell you about this project, which I showed in the end, this Aditi Greenscapes Element 5, it has been a very tough journey for me to convince the developer to use soil cement blocks.
Okay.
It has been very difficult for me to tell them that each of my balconies should be sunk so that they can be gardens. All balconies are sunk, so they all can be used as gardens. So, which was again a new process. I mean, people don't do sinking of the balconies and not as a normal process. So there are so many things I had to really pull them through, but they have come around, and now slowly. Earlier, they were like, okay, if you make it of mud, nobody will buy it. Now they themselves call it a premium project in the market. So it's like, it's a journey as an architect, which that's why I said, you have to be a catalyst of change as an architect. So you have to see that you fulfill those, and you cannot just do a one-off project or something like that and then say that, okay, everything else I will do normal construction and I will do one CSR project of my thing, which will be like this. So you have to live it, you have to actually be in it, and you have to believe in it to be able to do and work. And this is another thing, the hurried part that you asked me, this is really scary. Now the bamboo is like booming and everyone wants to work with bamboo. In that scenario, what has happened, there are many people who do not understand bamboo so well, but and they think that, the more bamboo shows in the building, the more beautiful or aesthetic it is. And it has come, I'm really sorry to use this word, but from the Green Bali concept of all bamboo buildings, which you actually cannot live in. You cannot live in a everyday life. So, and this what this has done is that we want to use bamboo for the poor people or the people who had been growing bamboo or something like that, where we have to house them and we have to bring them to a level. Now these people will sell their bamboos and again live in concrete houses, thereby completely shooting what we actually wanted to do and wanted to achieve by using bamboo for the masses. That will again go to again another 1% of the people who can have houses like the Bali houses, which are something like 15,000 rupees a square foot. I mean, how many people can actually afford that, and why they should? Mm-hmm. I mean, that is something, again, so you're using bamboo, but you're using bamboo in a different manner. And again, there are other kind of people who think that, again, the international style that they have in concrete and all can be also used in mud and bamboo and things like that, which again does not work, because natural materials have to be designed as per your climatic conditions. You have to give that, eave, which is long eave, to save your wall and things. That's what forms the vocabulary of the architecture. The way you see a mud house and identify a mud house is not a design of something. It's for a purpose. And that's why purpose-based architecture, need-based architecture, once you start doing it, these problems will automatically get solved. So instead of architects thinking I will do only 2-3 projects in a year and that will be like 10 lakh square feet and it would be like pigeonholes construction, and China telling that we do construction in 3 days or 4 days. You do construction in 3-4 days, but 1 year of planning goes into the factories. Don't ever you count that. So it's not like this, right? You produce the material, you start from the source. If you are thinking of steel, you start from the mining and then you reach the steel. If you see that, it is not actually really a very hurried, but yeah, those things are there. But then the architect has to make a choice. We have to make a choice what we really want to, and what we really want to, kind of world we want to make, what kind of states we want to create for the people to live. Do we want concrete shells, or do we want natural heavens where we will have no COVID? See, right now, most of the metros have more COVID problem than the villages. Or the less developed places are much more healthier, actually, which they thought otherwise, that the urban cities are very healthy, which is not, as we can all see. And it has really opened, you know, a plethora of issues and the things that people have been thinking that urban life is so good. Everyone has been running to the rural areas when the COVID came to get a fresher air or fresher something like that. Why not live in the fresh air all the time, rather than being only on the weekends? So this deurbanization will happen. So there's lot of work that needs to be done on this, you know, like by us architects. We have to take a call. We have to take a conscious call. They call it social architecture. I'm telling architecture is a social profession. We have to think in that way. We should be thinking in that way all the time. Yeah. I think that's when all these problems will probably, not happen. And then the client also will start understanding that, you know, what we are building will not sell, you know, like will not really, and we have to make people aware. Advocacy is another thing that we have to do. Because yeah. Architects will say, okay, I will give you in so many days. No, architects should put their foot down. No, I need so much of time. You will get your house in this much time. Factor it in your plans. It's just a matter of factoring, right? Yeah. I hope I answered your question.
Yes, ma'am, definitely. On that note, I have another question from Anjumala ma'am. So she asked, lots of work on going on in India in housing sector recently with bamboo replacing steel as reinforcement. What is your take on this?
I think we are still quite far from using it in normal buildings. And I think still a lot more research needs to be done by engineers. I have done my office and I have done in certain way. And I could not afford to get it tested at that time as to how it's working, because it's working. And I do not have any leakages because bamboo has been used. There are leakages because of other things once in a while, but that is not because bamboo has been used as a reinforcement. So we need to have, and so this is an example which is there now for 10 years and that we have a building. There are many other buildings earlier also which were there, which were actually using bamboo reinforcement traditionally. And they are 50, 60 year old buildings are there. We need to study them. We need to understand, take technology along, and then we need to actually frame some standards and things because with which people can actually design them. Because as I said, what is happening, there are new people coming in the name of bamboo. Everyone wants to get an edge because this is a niche market. And so if they say, I am a bamboo architect or I am a something like that, they'll start getting projects and people start approaching them. And somebody will say, I am a bamboo builder immediately. And they start getting big projects. A lot of problems can happen for people like us who have been trying to, like 22 years, I've been trying to mainstream bamboo. One problem or one mistake can put me also on my back foot as to how to really justify that, right? How do I tell the client next time, you know, if somebody else also, you know, does some mistake? So we have to be a very responsible people actually working. And so the client or the government or somebody also has to look at it. In university have to. So a lot of work needs to be done in this area. But we are almost there. A lot of work has been done, so they need to be evaluated. We need to get the empirical results from there and put it as a database as to, okay, this is how it should be designed. And then I think I feel it can definitely be used for small kind of projects. Smaller means residential projects, and where you have a lesser span, it, I think it can be easily used.
Wow, that's a wonderful thought. So far we have received two wonderful audiences with the question. Robert Rourke says, I want to use Bampley as thin and light as possible to build disaster relief housing for flatback rapid deployment when people are displaced by natural and political disaster. I want to organize farmers and unemployed youth to harvest and sustain and process the material to supply a Bampley factory. I want to find people who are making Bampley and to offer investment in machinery to increase production and to use the material to build millions of site appropriate shelter to alleviate the misery of refugee camps. Where can I find places where we can get sufficient amount of bamboos and labor to keep a modern Bampley factory working at peak efficiency? We want to use poor people to help poorer people. Will you help? That is Robert's query.
It's a very long, long listing.
Asking about Bampley, settling Bampley factory.
I think there are lots of pockets where bamboo pockets are there, or I would say where bamboo communities live. And they are the people with the lowest human development index. They are very poor. And they are not just poor, they are also considered untouchables. It would be a great thing to involve them. Excuse me, sorry. And there are a lot of bamboo forests, but I don't know how much is the accessibility now for all those forests, bamboo in the forest to the bamboo communities. Because I think they are rationed and given something like that. And from the forest, actually, it can be bought. But how good that would be, I have nothing. I cannot really say. One has to really find out. One more factor which has been going around, that bamboo has been flowering in the last few years. And bamboo, once it flowers, it dies. So, and each species flowers in a different, in a different manner or a different year or something like that. So I think people will have to really do a good survey as to where people think it is already flowered and the new bamboo shoots are coming. And government here, if it is in India, I think government is now giving a lot of support and some subsidy, not enough, but yes, enough, some subsidy to grow bamboo and plantations. And those, you don't need any permit from anybody. So some fellow lands and some other, what they call as bad lands or something like that, they can be used for growing bamboo and they can be utilized in that. A lot of people are going for plantations in different part of the country now with government support.
Okay. I hope Robert got his answer. So, Architect Poonam, she says, your work is commendable as you are innovating an age-old material for modern building. And she also asked, I'm curious how your building in bamboo are made long-lasting. I'm curious how bamboo can be made modern material without the tag of low cost.
No, my buildings never have a tag of low cost. I always call them cost-effective from day one. I mean, from the time I started practicing, not just bamboo, because I was always doing buildings which were supposed to be cost effective. I was doing for Ashraya in 40,000 rupees, you were giving 250 square feet space, which was a marathon task. So we always have been juggling with different kinds of materials and technologies and systems too. And so I have never used the word low cost, because the moment you say low cost, it is supposed to be for the poor people. And you think that, why should poor people have, something which is low cost, maybe today they are poor, tomorrow they may not be poor. Then how do you factor that in? I call them always cost effective. That is number one. And durability of bamboo and durability of, I would just not say stick to bamboo. I would also stick to mud buildings. Please go and see your great-great-grandfather's or mother's buildings in mud and bamboo. You will have an answer to your question. You don't have cement buildings, concrete buildings, have a life between 40 to 70 years only till date. But your mud buildings have lasted, some of the mud buildings across the world have lasted 700 years. And that's, I think, the question about the durability of these things. There are houses with bamboo. Even in Bangalore that I have seen where bamboo has been used for more than 200 years. In South America, you have more than 400 years old bamboo houses. But yes, they are used keeping the climate in mind. That is the key. They are not used keeping the fashion in mind. That's the difference. As I said, people, a look at all bamboo buildings is very exciting to people and very sexy and very fashionable, but it is not proper. If I try to do that in a different part, the climate is different. The way bamboo is used in our northeast or in Nepal, it cannot be used in the central part of India. It cannot be used the same way in Karnataka. So they all are used in different ways, in different climatic zones. And that, meaning you have to respect nature and nature's laws when you are trying to do this. And that's where
ma'am is again disconnected. Yes, ma'am. You're mute, ma'am.
So this is something which we really need to, if you have taken care of that, then your building will definitely survive. But if you don't take care of that and you try to expose bamboo, just like anything without the elements and same thing with mud and all that, your building will not last. Bamboo will not last. How do we work with our wood? We don't expose wood, right? We never expose wood. I mean, in very less, parts of the world, wood buildings are, wood is exposed. There's always a protective measure or protective mechanism which is put there. But similarly with bamboo also, and another thing is, why should we always think that bamboo should do everything? You can't have an all cement building, you can't have an all steel building, then why you should have all bamboo building? Use it the way it is supposed to be used, respecting its properties. I think that respect word is something like, you don't have to be excited with it. You really have to work with the material, understand the material and work with it. That is the key. And then bamboo lasts, and bamboo, it is never, as you saw my house, does it look low cost to you anywhere? I don't think it does.
Yeah, I think it depends on everyone's perspective as well. Yeah, but for me personally, I think it has wide range of materials, and it definitely doesn't look like a low cost. But then it also adds up value of sustainable material, and actually the term low cost is very vague in itself.
Yes,
because if we are not able to keep that maintenance cost, and what is the use of terming it as a low cost building? So
if you put steel out there, in 5-6 months it will start rusting.
True.
It will not last. So but nobody tells anything about that,
Yeah.
But let me tell you, if bamboo you put outside, it can even last for 5 years, because of the way things are. There are many things which are myths around these. And these are created by the people, marketing people of cement, marketing people of steel, political will, real estate lobby. They have created this thing that, this is more long lasting and this is less. That is not the case. That is not the case. So that is something which is really created as a myth. They want to sell their own things. So who will sell bamboo? There's nobody to... on the TV, have you ever seen any ad on the TV, use bamboo? No, nobody does that, right?
I think everyone believes in interesting words and new terms, and every day also depends upon the marketing stake. So how much
Yes.
percentage are you willing
Yes.
to give us so we will be able to market your product? So that's how
Yes.
So well, I think by this time we have come to our come to an end to our series. I would like to thank you so much for being here with us in this platform, and with this I would like to request, I mean, I would like also for your kind advice to all of us as a practicing architects with to close our series with your last few words.
Okay. I think you really have to be very resilient. The kind of capitalistic world that we are living in, and the forces that we are fighting. Even the green revolution, what they say, or green building revolution, what they say, it has been completely hijacked. It has been completely hijacked by the same capitalists who are, you know, on one hand, they are, sponsoring the Earth Day. On the other hand, they are shaking hands with the oil economy and the other people and promoting that. So they have their hands in both. And the term which says green makes big good business sense is something which I think is very highly, I find it a very toxic kind of a sentence to use. Everything is with business. I would say green should make people happy. That happiness index, that happiness of people, the well-being of people. These materials which we are already talking about, mud and bamboo and all that, they are not just, they give you a healthier atmosphere, healthier ambience to live. You have less asthma, you have less all these kind of things. Pushing these things against these corporations who have huge marketing budgets to shut your mouth. You have to be very, very resilient and very, very tenacious. If we all are architects, want to make a better world, that is something I think we all have to be very tenacious and conscious as to what we are doing and how things are going. Right? I have one small request. Anju is also there. We are trying to do this programs through our Bamboo Society of India in the curriculum development in the architectural schools and engineering schools for sustainable technologies, including bamboo. So it would be nice if we could have a chapter of Bamboo Society of Nepal, out there, and we could help you with incorporating these in the colleges and doing things like that to further enhance. I mean, I would be very happy to. I am chairing the steering committee of architect members of Bamboo Society of India to take this work to the student, and the faculty members and students and of architecture and engineering disciplines. So I would be most happy to collaborate with the Sona would like to collaborate. We would be most happy to, go ahead with that. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. We have almost come to an end of the series, and I really hope our viewers, along with me, we are taking something back home after this series. So I would like to request our president, Anju ma'am, to close this series with a few words from her.
Namaste, everyone. Thank you, Neelam ma'am. That closing remark was really very touching, and about sharing your information on bamboo with our schools of architecture. That would also be a very good idea. I will try to talk to the faculty members, and maybe we can arrange a series of guest lectures first, in some of the schools of architecture, so that they get to know what it's all about. Hopefully some of the faculty members are in with us today, and since it's live on Facebook, they'll be watching this episode in the days ahead also. And it's been a very enlightening session. Yes, with this pandemic, everybody is talking about getting closer to nature. So we as architects, hopefully some of us will also be practicing, you know, in the unconventional way, I should say, playing with the natural materials, because talking about the context of India and Nepal, we have so much of similarity socially, culturally, and with the materials also. I was in on your webinar with Dr. Vandana Shiva also, and she also basically speaks on the same wavelength about nature. So it's really been very nice. I would like to thank all the audience that are with us today for this session. And we really look forward to collaborating with you, you know, with the Organization of Society of Nepalese Architects, as well as with some of the schools of architecture. I will definitely be talking to some of them, and we'll be getting back to you. And hopefully we get to meet soon once this situation is over. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am, for being with us today.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you, Hina.